the purple book, the Chalice Phrase, number 108, As the Deer.
Thank you. love divine, the love's excelling joy of heaven to earth come down. Fix in us thy humble dwelling, all thy faithful mercies crown. Jesus, thou art all compassion, pure unbounded love thou art. Visit us with thy salvation, enter every trembling heart. Breathe, oh, breathe thy loving spirit into every troubled breast. Let all fall in thee inherit. Let us find thy promised rest. Take away our love of sinning, Alpha and Omega be, end of faith as its beginning, set our hearts at liberty. Finish then thy new creation, pure and spotless let us be. Let us see thy great salvation, perfectly restored in thee. Changed from glory into glory, till in heaven we take our place. Till we cast our crowns before thee, lost in wonder, love, and grace.
Please be seated. We have a couple of announcements of the things that are going on in the life of our church that we want to share with you. Today at 6 o'clock, The Rock will be meeting. That is the ecumenical youth group. We partner with the Methodists and the Presbyterians and the Nazarenes for a group that meets together of 6th to 12th graders every Sunday evening from 6 to 7:30 to time to share in the faith together, to have some fun, and hopefully maybe a little bit learn some things. So if you're a 6th to 12th grader, you're invited to join them at the Rock Building, which is right next to the Methodist Building. I think it's that way, if I have my bearings correctly. Each week, we gather on Zoom on Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. for a Bible study that I lead. We gather to look forward to the upcoming Sunday's scripture and how it intersects with our everyday life. And so you're invited to join us for that. We meet at 7, like I said, and we email out the link and also post it to our church's Facebook page. So if you're wanting to join us, you can find the link to the Zoom room that way. Also, next week on May 15th, Super Sam is going to be having their, I don't know if it's annual, but their golf outing that they're going to be have, raising funds to help families and kids fighting childhood cancer. If you want to have more information how you can participate, how you can support this cause, please see Cassie Santoff after. We also have a poster that is posted on the church bulletin board that is across the way from the bathrooms, if you make your way. Cassie, wave your hand so if anybody wants to come see you, they can come see Cassie. There's Cassie right there. She has wonderful information to share with you about that. And then on a little bit of sad note, I wanted to let you know that our esteemed music director, Martha Hogan, has informed us that she's going to be resigning at the end of this month to spend a little bit more time in travel. She has some big trips planned for later this summer and is being a very good and studious grandma most of the week, and that's pulling her to St. Louis. So we're going to be saying goodbye to our lovely music director at the end of this month. So we'll be taking the next month or next couple weeks to honor you and say thank you for the work that you've done throughout this pandemic time. So thank you, Martha.
Now is not the true embarrassment time. That will come on May 30th, where we make her parade in front of everybody and say thank you. But we are glad to have you with us at least the next couple of weeks. And now we're going to move to a time of prayer, and to prepare our hearts for prayer, we're going to have a brief moment of silence and stillness where you're invited to offer your own prayers. That can be whatever you have, or it can just be a moment of quiet in an otherwise very loud and busy world. So we'll go to the Lord in silence, and then I'll lead us in the pastoral prayer. So let's pray together. In peace, we join our hearts and minds with you, O Lord. When I say, let us pray to the Lord, please respond with, Lord, have mercy. For the Holy Church of God, that it may be filled with truth and love and be found without fault the day of your coming, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For all who fear God and believe in you, Lord Christ, that our divisions may cease and that all may be as one as you and the Father are one, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the mission of the church, that in faithful witness may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who do not believe, and for those who have lost their faith, that they may receive the light of the good news, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and peoples, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those in positions of public trust, that they may serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, for refugees, prisoners, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this congregation, for those who are present and for those who are absent, that we may be delivered from hardness of heart and show forth your glory in all that we do, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For our enemies, and for those who wish us harm, and for all whom we have injured or offended, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For ourselves, for the forgiveness of our sins, for the grace of the Holy Spirit to amend our lives, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For all who have commended themselves to our prayers, for our families, friends, and neighbors, that being freed from anxiety, they may live in joy, peace, and health, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For all who have died in the communion of your church, and for those whose faith is known to you alone, that with all the saints they may have rest in the last place, where there is no pain or grief, life eternal. We pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. Lord, hear the prayers of your people, and what we have asked faithfully, grant that we may obtain effectually to the glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the one who taught us to pray together by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now we're going to have some very special music. So I'm going to turn it over to the aforementioned music director, Martha Hogan.
If I could have the youth, especially
I don't know how to follow that. I mean, our scripture reading for today comes from the first letter of John in the New Testament, chapter 5, verses 1 through 6. We ask God's blessing to be with us as we read these holy words. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God. Whoever loves someone who is a parent loves the child born to the parent. This is how we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and keep God's commandments. This is the love of God, we keep God's commandments. God's commandments are not difficult because everyone who is born from God defeats the world. And this is the victory that has defeated the world, our faith. Who defeats the world? Isn't it the one who believes that Jesus is God's Son? This is the one who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. Not by water only, but by water and blood. And the Spirit is the one who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And I hope the kids didn't get too comfortable because they're invited to come back up for this morning's children's moment. So wherever. Make it up as you go. Who knows, right, Bryson? Who knows? Who knows where we're going to sit? It doesn't matter. I usually sit on a stool, but I'm going to sit on these risers because I'm super cool. All right. Growing up, I played several different sports. I know you can tell by my athletic ability that you can see through this robe that I'm super buff, super fast, super all the things. But I grew up playing first soccer. I was okay at soccer. I was a goalie, so I wasn't fast, and I wasn't really good with a ball, so they just stuck me in the back. But so I played soccer, and then I played basketball, but I wasn't particularly tall. My brother is 6'4". He played on the practice team for the Iowa women's thing. Because he's so tall, he got to play against the collegiate women at Iowa. I was not that good. And so they politely asked me to no longer play basketball. I played baseball, and that was the sport that I played for the most of my childhood. I played from, you know, like, I don't know, when I was 6 into when I graduated high school. And I was okay, but when you grow up, you kind of get old, and your body starts to break down, and I tore two of my rotator cuffs in my shoulder, so I couldn't play baseball anymore. And then I played football, too. But I was also really good at football, so good that I had like 3 concussions, my 8th grade year, my 9th grade year, my 10th grade year, and so I had to take a break. And then when I played football again, I was just a kicker, because you can't get a concussion when you're a kicker. They're not allowed to hit you, so that was how I got around it. But one of the things I learned in all the different sports that I had to play was that, what do you have when you play sports? Usually there is an adult there who tries to help you, teach you, provide some like rules on how to play, provide some structure on what things. What's that person normally called? A coach, right. I had lots of different coaches. I had Coach Fitzpatrick, who was my baseball coach. I had Coach Gunther, who was my football coach. I had Coach Hornaback, who was another football coach. And I had some more coaches that I don't even remember their names. But what happens when you have a really, really good coach?
You get really good.
Generally, what happens? The best coaches have the best players. Usually, when you have the best coach, you're going to have the best team. Now, I was thinking about this, coaches, because I read something this week about our scripture, about the Olympics. I'm going to read it to you. Young athletes aiming for the Olympics move to live near or even live with their coaches. Their whole lives, what they eat,
where they go to school, how they train in their sport, are directed by their coaches. In the terms of our scripture today, they obey their coach in all things. Now, I was never good enough so that I had to live with my coach, and he didn't get to tell me what to eat. But I did have to obey my coach in case I wanted to be the best, I don't know, football, soccer, basketball, whatever sport. And it extends to all walks of life, not just sports. You know, if you play music, you normally have a teacher, and they're trying to help you get better. Your parents, even too, have some rules, maybe, because they want to help you be the best people you can grow up to be. So too with us as Christians. You know, I don't like to make this allusion a lot, but Jesus sort of operates as our coach. He gives us, you know, love when we need it. He gives us some correction when we need it. And he gives us some rules that we're obey. And they're not rules just for the sake of having rules, but they're for the best things for us. And those two rules generally are that we say, love God and love neighbors. Those are generally our best rules. And if we can follow those, we're pretty much going to be the best people that we can be. And, you know, Jesus is a little bit like our coach every once in a while. All right. Now, I won't detail you any more of my exploits about my great esteemed career as an athlete. But instead, we're going to close in prayer. I'm going to invite you to go back to your seats. So let's pray together. Even you, Brooklyn, let's pray together. Let's pray. Gracious God, we are thankful. Thankful that you love us and invite us to love you and our neighbors, and that doing so, we might flourish in all that we do. We pray this in your name. Amen. Thanks for joining me, guys. I'll share more stories about how much of a failure at sports I am as we go. Go on ahead. You're fine. I should say, if I don't want to toot my horn too much, I did play football in college as a kicker and punter. And my esteemed Culver Stockton Wildcats were a whole 2-42 the entire time I was there. That's right, we won 2 games my entire collegiate career. I was really good. Will you pray with me? O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. I don't know about you, but it feels like 1 John has been harping on the same message for a while now. If you have not joined us, we've been waking our way through this small book in the back of the New Testament. And every week it seems like the same word comes up again and again. And again, love. Like a beginning jazz musician who falls in love with the same note and just plays it over and over and over. Or a washed-up pitcher who has only one pitch left to throw. Or some actor like Kevin Costner, who my wife says really only plays the same character over and over and over, just in different movies, and so we're not allowed to watch Field of Dreams. It seems like John has one theme that he's trying to make sure that we get across. Because we have been loved by God, we ought to love one another. He says, we love because God first loved us. It's like one of my favorite organizations, Mockingbird, for whom I read and write for from time to time. They're named Mockingbird because they always say the same thing in slightly different ways. They repeat the good news of the gospel in all they do, mimicking the grace given, sharing the good news of God's love in Jesus' death and resurrection, shouting the gospel of forgiveness for sinners for all to hear. And that's what it all comes back to, and that's what John is always trying to get across. Left in the wreckage of division, their church has been divided. And John is at pains to counsel those left over to take up
what Jesus does. Take up the self-sacrificial, mercy-laden, grace-forward, forgiveness-giving good news, the ministry of Christ with one another. Share it with one another because that they have already experienced this good news. God has loved them to the end, and that love transforms them into people who would share in Jesus' ministry. He calls this living in the light. He calls this remaining in the truth in relationship with Jesus. He calls it abiding in the God who is love. He calls it believing that Jesus forgives and atones for our sin. He calls it loving one another. John optimistically phrases it this way for our ears today. Whoever loves someone who is a parent loves the child born to that parent. He's once again referring to us as God's children, with God being our divine parent. Now, Cinderella might have some qualms with John after her relationship with her stepmother and stepsisters, who should love Cinderella if they, you know, marry Cinderella's dad. The idea is that if we love God, then we also love God's children. We love each other. But love is just one side of a coin. The other side, John says, is belief. If we love God, then we believe Jesus is the Son of God. That at a particular time, in a particular place, God came to dwell with sinners. That an itinerant Jewish rabbi and teacher who wandered around in the backwaters of the empire, just outside the middle of nowhere, was the seat of God's presence in the world. That through his horrifically public torture and execution, humanity might find forgiveness. That through his unfathomable resurrection, sin, death, and the devil had been defeated. And this world indeed has been defeated. Remaking all things, including you and me here today, the way they always should have been. Just as love is not a general term but finds its seat in Jesus, faith is not a general term. It has a particular expression and content. It's not a generic one-size-fits-all type of faith, or the sitcom How I Met Your Mother's The Universe Loves You or Hates You type of faith. It's not a choose-your-own-adventure book, my favorite book growing up. It's not that style of faith. No. John's testimony assumes that Christians do not approach God as a generally religious people praying to whom it may concern. Faith, then, is faith in God's story of Jesus. Loving God is believing Jesus truly is the Son of God, Jesus, who is the grace, mercy, and forgiveness that he gives us. That is the center of our faith. When I was in school in Texas, my preaching professor's wife planted a new church there in Fort Worth. Instead of calling it one of the more traditional names of a church, I don't know, like First Christian Church, that one was actually already taken, or the sort of new names that churches give themselves, like New Journey Church, they went a different way in naming this group. Betraying their love and faith in God, at least according to 1 John, they named their church plant after the scientist Galileo. They named it Galileo Church because their tagline was going to be, "We are not the center of the universe." And the corollary with the follow-up is, implied, God revealed in the redemptive life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ is the center of the universe. This is what belief is, believing that Jesus is the center of the world, that his love, that his death and resurrection are what hinges all of history. It's the confession of Jesus as Christ. Who God is, what God does, is found in Jesus. When you spin the coin, you no longer see two distinct things, belief and love. They are indeed one and the same. They blend into one another. They bleed into one another. Belief is not a chance bond that unites us as believers, which perhaps could be replaced by anything, I don't know, our affiliation with our favorite baseball team. It should be the now streaking Chicago Cubs, I'm sure. Or the fact that we just find ourselves here in Fulton at this exact time and place, or any of the other things with which we might connect each other. No, belief is the established framework within the love of God, and love for fellow believers is made both possible and necessary. Think about it like this. When I was growing up, we would go off to my grandparents' acreage, and in the back, you walked a little bit ways. There was a pond there. It was for the cows to drink. But every once in a while, my brother and I would throw as big a rocks as we could. Even though he was bigger, like I said, I was always stronger than him and could always throw bigger rocks. And what would happen is when you throw a rock into a pond, it creates ripples emanating from the center. Out of God's love in Christ, that is the center of our faith, the center of our being, radiates the love of God, radiates belief and trust in God's promises, radiates our love for one another. They're like ripples that go out. And then John adds one more. Out of the center of Jesus radiates obedience to God's commandments. And I don't know about you, but I have an aversion to the word obedient. Maybe it's because I associate with taking my dog to school and trying to make him obey my commandments. He still does what he wants most of the time. Or I don't particularly enjoy the clothing company Obey and their streetwear clothes. Or the fact that I've never been the world's best rule follower, and that I don't usually obey rules unless someone explains to me why they have them. Maybe that might be the reason I wasn't such a good basketball or soccer player. I didn't understand. Who knows? But if you're anything like me, you bristle a little bit when John brings up obedience as a way to show love for God and for each other. He says, "This is how we know that we love God, that we love the children of God. When we love God and keep God's commandments, this is the love of God, and we keep God's commandments." We keep God's law. That's how we should show that we love God. Of course, when we hear commandment, we think of the Ten Commandments. You know, Charlton Heston in a long beard holding up two stone tablets from way long ago. At least that's where my mind goes. I think of God's perfect and holy law given to the Israelites as a gift for their life, for the flourishing of their life together. The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 6, spells it out well. When Moses was standing on the precipice of the Holy Land, he takes time to tell his brothers and sisters, his siblings, why the law is important. He writes, "Now these are the commandments, the regulations, and the case laws that the Lord your God commanded me to teach you to follow in the land you are entering to possess, so that you will fear the Lord your God by keeping all his regulations and his commandments that I'm commanding you, both you, your daughters, and your sons, all the days of your life, and so that you will lengthen your life." They're given for flourishing. They're given for benefit. They're given so lives might be lived rightly in God's eyes. The problem is that the law cannot make what it wills. It cannot create what it asks for. Simply telling us what to do does not make us want to do it. Or in the opposite, telling us not to do something does not make us not want to do it. Telling someone not to do something is a surefire way to make them want to do it. I shared this example with a couple of boys who are getting baptized in a few weeks. When your mom told you not to eat any of the cookies that she had just made or just bought, What do you do for the rest of the afternoon? You think, man, I really want those cookies. Or from the movie Inception, if I tell you not to think about elephants, what are you thinking about? Elephants. Because of sin's effect on the world and in our hearts, we cannot follow the precepts of the law because we will always turn them into an avenue of self-justification. Instead of being a way to honor God, we turn the law into another tool. We can separate ourselves from one another, showing how much more holy, how much perfect, how much better we are than one another. We turn them into a way that we can substitute ourselves to do the work of God. And so even though John spells out a slightly different commandment or law previously in his letter when he says, this is his commandment, that we should believe in the name of his son Jesus and love one another, the effect is still the same. It's not something we always do perfectly every single time. We fail. We're not perfect. And if we're honest with ourselves, we know that this happens every single day. And Jesus, in the Sermon on the Mount, did say, be perfect as your heavenly Father and as your Father in heaven is perfect. So if we are to be perfect, we fail every day. The times that we do happen to get something right are those times we don't even know what we're doing. As Jesus says, when the left hand doesn't know what the right hand is doing. And this is true in life in the church. Loving each other in the church is hard because we are still people. Our personalities compete with one another. Our preferences on worship style, worship time, worship music, how long the preacher drones on and on and on, they're all different. Our ideas on what is most important for us as Christians to do or not do varies from one another. And we all think what we think is right. There are plenty of reasons why we might find it hard to love one another, even when we don't bring in the continual effects of sin, death, and the devil. But the good news is that Jesus gives us the love commanded here. If God is love and if God is perfect and we are commended to be perfect and we fail, our love can never be as pure or like God's. But thankfully, our frenzied attempts at loving one another isn't the greatest love. God in Christ on the cross is. God's love is forgiveness of your sins through Jesus' atoning death and new life for you in his resurrection. The love Jesus commands, he gives to us in baptism and every week in bread and cup. When we abide there, remain there, stay in Jesus' love and his forgiveness and grace, it changes us. Changes us from the inside out. Martin Luther put it this way. The love of God does not first discover, but creates that which is pleasing to it. God creates in us the love that is perfect. God does not wait for us to love him and one another to call us good. God does not wait for us to believe in the story before giving us faith. God creates something out of nothing, life out of death. In baptism, we die a death like Christ so we might be raised to new life like his through water and blood. We are transformed into Christians. Literally, that word means little Christ. We are transformed every time we gather around the table because we stay there a little bit longer and hear of how God in Christ loved us to the end. In so doing, we die to ourselves on behalf of others. We love, in other words. And so John makes the circle complete. We love because God first loved us. That is the good news of Easter. That is the good news of our faith. That is the good news we need every day. Amen. As we prepare our hearts to join at that table and hear once again that good news, you're invited to stand and sing our communion hymn, Let Us Talents and Tongues Employ. It's number 422 in the Chalice Hymnal. You're invited to sing all three verses. You are invited by Christ to come to his table and receive the fullness of our faith at a feast prepared for you because it is prepared for all of God's people. Open your hearts and minds to the truth that this table proclaims, a coming world at one in peace, a people reconciled to and loved by one another, lives made new and grounded in the forgiveness and hope of Christ's death and resurrection. Come to this table, receive the bread and cup, Christ's body and blood, the gifts of our faith. Experience once again the grace which gives life to weary, sin-sick souls. Each time we gather, we retell our story of faith. It was on the night on which Jesus was betrayed. He took a loaf of bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." You are now invited to eat of the bread of life. And likewise, after supper, he took the cup. And after giving thanks, he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood for the forgiveness of sin." You're now invited to drink the cup of salvation. Dear friends, as often as we do this, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Will you join me in prayer? Eternal God, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. As we remember Jesus, we are reminded of how clearly his life demonstrated the truth that giving is the only proper expression of loving. Surely one can give without loving, but one cannot love without giving. So God loved the world so much that he gave his only Son, John says in his gospel. You're invited to show your love for God and for one another in sharing your gifts, offerings, and tithes. You can place your gifts in the offering plates as you go, if you have not already, or by donating online. If you want to donate online, see me afterwards and I can share how that's possible. I don't carry a checkbook each week, so I have to give online. So I know how to do it, so I can share it with you. So if you would like more information, please see me afterwards. And now you are invited to stand as we once again sing our faith. We'll be singing the Easter hymn, Crown Him with Many Crowns, which is number 234. In the chalice hymnal, I should say, in the red book.
Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthems drown all music but its own. Awake my soul and sing of him who died for thee. And hail him as thy matchless king through all eternity. Crown him the Lord of life, who triumphed o'er the grave and rose victorious in the strife for those he came to save. His glories now we sing, who died and rose on high, who died eternal life to bring, that death may die. Crown him the Lord of peace, whose power a scepter sways, who rules through pole that wars may cease and all be prayer and praise. His reign shall know no end, and round his pierced feet fair flowers of paradise, dear fragrance ever sweet. Crown him the Lord of love, behold his hands and side, those wounds yet visible above in beauty glorified. Those Redeemer, hail, for thou hast died for me. Thy praise and glory shall not fail throughout eternity.
And let us receive now this benediction. Go forth trusting in your new birth from God, sharing the love you received, and testifying to the truth from the Spirit. Go in peace to serve. Amen.